In this edition of Art Loft, a photographer who's documented some of politics' most iconic figures.
It's the type of picture I'm looking for, sometimes I don't even know.
How one artist creates masterpieces from plywood.
I try to let the work flow, and I just kind of follow along with it.
And a man whose art extends beyond the canvas.
If I just made beautiful paintings, what I'm trying to get at within the work would be lost.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the Nelson Tirado Art Gallery in Coral Gables, this is Art Loft.
Welcome to Art Loft. Tonight, nature inspires a man to create three-dimensional landscapes, and we meet a sculptor who transforms the ordinary into functional art. But now, at a time when all eyes are on the upcoming elections, we take a look at the work of photographer Terry Guidison. She spent her career photographing some of the country's iconic political and cultural figures, from Jesse Jackson to Prince. Here's a look inside her studio.
For me, there's a difference between a photograph and a picture. A photograph is a snap. A picture is something that really says something, that's going to stand the test of time, that people can look at 100 years from now and learn something from it, or be intrigued by it, or poses more questions, perhaps. I'm Terry Guidison, and I'm a freelance documentary photographer. The documentary part, for me, has always been the most interesting form of photography. I'm not as much of a director. I like to go into a situation of chaos and find the picture. And I don't set things up with any of my work. And I've been pretty lucky at finding images that come together, and when it looks right, I push the button. The political work, I've gone for not necessarily the candidate who's gonna win. It's more of the passion, you know, sometimes the underdog, sometimes people that I'm completely have opposite views of. I was just starting my career when the opportunity came along to be Jesse Jackson's photographer. That was people's reactions to Jackson, which to me was the most amazing part. There's just so much more that you can learn about a story by looking at the edges rather than just the central attention. It went right from Jackson to Wellstone, because all the Jackson people were working on Paul Wellstone's campaign. I'd never heard of Paul Wellstone. A friend of mine had said that, oh yeah, you should follow him, you'll probably like him. You know, he doesn't have a chance of winning, but you'll probably like him. And I thought, you know, okay, so, and I did like him. And he was very unusual, you know, going in and hugging everybody, and he was this little guy, and he had all this energy. So he was really interesting. When I heard the news of his death, I rushed right over to the office and documented that time period. And then shortly after that time, University of Minnesota Press asked me about doing a book, a collection of photographs. The book is definitely an archive of, for me, one of the greatest politicians Minnesota's ever had. I had to go through 12 years of my life looking for what might be the important images. The photo of them that's on the cover of the book, I remember the moment very clearly because it was on election day of 96 and it was supposed to be his last time he was going to run. So, you know, it was like, oh, this is going to be the last hurrah. And I was back. There was this platform on the back of the bus. And we were in Uptown. We were having a great day. They were driving all through different places. And there was another picture on the same roll that is from the inside of the bus that shows the two of them. I love that picture. And that was the one that I always chose. And then it was going through the proof sheets when I was editing for the book that I discovered that one. And it you know, right away, I just thought, okay, it's a great moment. And it really captures their energy and spirit probably better than any other photograph I ever made of them. Because I've been photographing politics for so many years, the type of picture I'm looking for, sometimes I don't even know, except that I am looking for metaphors that speak either about the candidate, the issues at hand. Well, I think it was the Republican convention that year, actually, the year that, what was that, in 92, with George Bush, and Pat Buchanan was giving his speech and slamming, you know, the media, slamming liberals, gays and lesbians, and like I fell into all these categories and people were cheering as he condemned these people, and I'm in the middle of the floor going, oh my God, this is scary. So I think maybe one thing I'm trying to do is maybe wake people up a little bit to pay attention and to be involved. I'm most known for the political work, I think probably because of the Wellstone book, but basically I'm a storyteller. And I love telling stories, and I've done projects on homeless mothers in transition. I did a project for the History Center on Minnesota snowbirds. You know, for a while I had a column in City Pages called Terry Guidison's Daybook, and it was a great little thing where every Tuesday I brought a new photo in that was, you opened up page 3, it was right there. And it was no cut line, it was just, it had to be a good photo. And I still try to pretend that I have that, you know, just a day book, you know, slice of life pictures. So, I mean, I try to do that a lot of just what's around me, what's in my own backyard, what's, you know, what's on my walk today. I had gotten a phone call from another photographer who had told me that Prince was looking for a photographer. And it's a long story on how the whole thing happened, but I ended up being hired to document his 1992 tour to Europe. And it resulted in a book of photographs called Prince Presents the Sacrifice of Victor. His title, not mine. The parts that were most fun was actually the after concert gigs, because he'd have the concert and he'd go and jam for 2-3 hours. And that's where I made, you know, some of my best pictures, because then it was a different kind of a thing. There was more audience interplay, you know, everything was closer, it was very intimate. You know, one of my favorites was after he had just jammed for like 45 minutes on one song at the end, and he went down behind stage and just laid back on the floor. And there's almost sort of this religious nature of him stretched out like Christ on the floor in a way. Probably the best part of the experience was seeing what a genius he is, a musical genius. And to be able to have this record of that period of time recorded, again, ties into my whole feeling of like wanting to be a visual historian that leaves a record. And, you know, this is definitely one of Minnesota's greatest artists, and it was a privilege for me to be able to watch him make his music and just observe that artistry.
You can view other works by this artist and even follow her blog by logging on to terryguidison.com.
If I just made beautiful paintings, what I'm trying to get at within the work would be lost.
Now, meet a man who makes a living from turning the ordinary into the extraordinary. David Knopp takes basic sheets of plywood and shapes them into smooth, sloping works of art that actually double as furniture. See for yourself.
When people first see my work, I'm not sure if they look at it and go, oh, that's a piece of furniture. I do pause at times when people ask me, what exactly do you do? I don't know why, but I got into shooting photographs of trees in the wintertime, bare of leaves. You can actually see the contours and the surfaces, and I'll interpret them into drawings. There's movement in my drawings, and I take that a step farther and try to keep the movement going on in my sculpture. I use no 3D software to design these. It's usually an intuitive process. I'll take a piece of 4x8 sheet of plywood and cut a template for a starting point, maybe a nice curve, and I'll just build off of that one piece at a time and coming up with a rough basic shape of the piece itself. Plywood in itself is not a very exciting material. You know, it's basically a construction product. It works well for me because I'm interested in the end grains of the plywood, because as I carve it, the strata, which acts as lines, you can express all kind of movement. It actually becomes the lines that your eyes follow. Process to me is my way of kind of escaping. When I'm out in my studio working, that's some of the best time I have. I try to let the work flow, and I just kind of follow along with it. In my work, I'm always trying to find my own voice. And the work itself has its own voice. You can control that more and more with your tool itself. It's like a pencil when you're drawing, you know, or a piece of charcoal. Well, there was an old statement at one time, in order to create, you must destroy. Unfortunately, to create plywood, you are destroying trees. It's nice to be able to reverse that and take this man-made product, which is nothing but a bunch of veneers glued together, and turn that into something that's worthwhile looking at.
Artwork from this collection was even featured in an episode of HBO's Veep television series. To learn more about this sculptor, enter davidknopf.com. Gregory Euclid is not an average landscape painter. In a stunning show of flying pencils and scraping spatulas, he brings his paintings to life. And his intuitive attack on the canvas is almost as breathtaking as the finished piece. Here's Gregory's story.
Well, as a young artist, I started just drawing mostly because that's how you could get attention. And like any psychologist will tell you, if you get attention from doing something, you'll continue to do it. This is where I get my material. Every time it rains, you can find, this is some kind of styrofoam. You'll find it all over here.
Time's a software for mouth to dress, breaking all the rules. I'm going down, down for you.
If someone hasn't seen my work before, I tend to describe it as landscape painting, maybe contemporary landscape painting.
So what I'll do is pick it all up and put it in my pocket and bring it back.
Whenever I try to explain it to someone, it ends up getting very long-winded and very confusing, and I usually just end up saying, oh, it's landscape painting. It's got to keep raining, otherwise I'll run out of supplies. Well, I use the styrofoam in my work to kind of symbolize this thing that's man-made but omnipresent in the landscape. So it's not very difficult to find this stuff everywhere you go. So sometimes I'll use a spatula to scrape the paint across the surface and let the paint kind of act as paint and not appear so representational. I also like the way that it kind of scumbles along the surface.
You were born into a strange world, like a candle you were meant to share the fire. I don't know where we come from, I don't know where we go, but my arms are made to hold you, so I will never let you go, because you were born.
So there's land here, and in the center of this scene, I'm going to create some type of industry that moves in and kind of starts, is built upon that land. The stuff that's around this is going to be more deliberate and organized because it's a city. So city planning is much different than, you know, a natural prairie or a forest. I think of it as experience and memory. So when I go out into a forest, I walk through the forest and I'm experiencing these vignettes moment by moment. And by vignettes, I mean there's maybe you walk down a hill and you remember that moment of walking down the hill, or you come across a pond and then you remember seeing that or spending the time there, and then you move on to a new place. And you start to think about the ecosystem in general. It's just, it's overwhelming. It's impossible for one person to understand what's even going on in 1 foot of space in the forest. And that complexity and that density has always been a part of my work.
To chase the light, 'cause you were born.
It's like, you think that's just a city? Well, no, it's there used to be oak savanna there. And before the oak savanna, it used to be hunted by, you know, Dakota and Sioux. And before that, it's like the history of spaces we often forget about. This is nature, like dead nature, and then culture. So you've got coffee cups, styrofoam. It's like, this is the perfect blending pot right here. This is like reality, what exists. I've got this type of framework established here, and the water works great because I can go and erase things. So like this area right here, if I spray that up close, you can see that like any paint that was still wet will start to fall away, and you get this pattern of decay. And then having that actually happen on the surface of the painting always seemed interesting. Them, they need to dry like that. Think about what's represented two-dimensionally and sometimes try to create a complement to it three-dimensionally. This all started by, I made some paintings that had two or three sheets of paper on, and I would go through and I would rip through them, and then I'd start painting the next scene onto that, as though it's like a moment in time, and then you pass through the threshold of that moment into the next stage. The paint that dripped down would pool up inside of these like relief areas. I thought, okay, well that relief area then becomes a lake. Well, what's gonna happen around a lake? You're gonna get, there's water there, so you're gonna have growth up around the lake. So it seemed like a rich place to kind of start putting the relief elements in, just having them, you know, stand there like that, because they can't. Because the paper comes out in relief, then the objects can use that as a foothold to start. It's like on a side of a cliff, any rock that comes out, there's gonna be something that's growing on there, whereas on the cliff face, it's much more rare. When I bring sculptural elements in or like pieces from the land, I have a tendency to think about modes of representation. So you have an illusionistic space that's painted where people can go in with their mind. You have a space that actually comes out that people can move around with their body. And then you have these like fake kind of model type materials that are produced on there, trees that I make from sedum, or like, you know, the architectural type of things. So I started fooling around with various plastic bags. The idea that you can take and make a form that looks like something natural out of something that's, you know, petroleum based and completely destructive, and have that in this landscape, that's kind of important, because the landscape itself seems very picturesque, but you know, these are the things that we use on a daily basis that are the antithesis to this kind of idea. All of these different modes of representation get introduced into the sculptural mix, and it's kind of left to the viewer to negotiate what those, how those things blend together. And if I just made beautiful paintings, what I'm trying to get at within the work would be lost. You know, so if I can introduce as much garbage as possible from the land into the work, that kind of reflects on the state of land today, as well as making the painting a little bit more realistic to me. I want it to feel like I'm present in the land in general, you know, and it contains all of the thoughts that I have. I think that's how I want to just keep making it more and more realistic in that sense. When I look at a landscape painting, I think that's like 1/12 of the story.
Euclid's work was featured at Pulse Contemporary Art Fair in Miami. For details, visit gregoryeuclid.com. Thanks so much for joining us this week. Remember, you can visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. Also, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. That's very pretty, right? I know, it's weird. And no, that's what I feel like I should be saying. How can I say, now meet a man who makes a living, like that feels more natural to me. Now meet a man who makes a living from turning the ordinary into the extraordinary. Yeah? All right. Press it. Beep. Okay. HBO's Veep television series. Beep. Beep.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.